to welcome everybody here. This is a chance for you to really get a bit of an education outside the classroom. This is an opportunity that we have here. We have some very distinguished scholars that come out here and given time out of their very busy schedule, because they've also got pretty busy schedules just like yourselves. So we are very privileged to have them all here today. Learned experts on their field. And this is something that's going to be a fairly thorny issue, not only in their time, but also in yours, as you continue to grow up and you go out and become leaders of sailors and Marines. This is an issue where we've got some nationalist fervor going on in Russia, and we've got some other issues going on in Ukraine, there's Georgia, there's a lot of underlying themes that are going on here that we don't always see readily, we don't always get in the news, and the only way you're going to get it is if you do a little bit of homework and you do some study and you pick the brains of scholars like these to find out really what's the truth behind the whole matter, okay? So I would ask that you listen, that you would have some great questions, because this is your opportunity. This is your chance to now go out there and ask folks who are from the well of knowledge, if you will, who have studied this for their whole lives, are intimately involved with this, and can convey that to you, and they want to come here and convey that to you. So that is our privilege. We've got them here. So I would ask that you would pay close attention. As you were asked, if you do have to leave, do it discreetly. This is we're here on their time for their symposium. This is a great benefit for us. So first of all, I want to welcome you all. Thank you all very much for coming here today. I look forward to a great symposium with Mr. Shipman, Professor Sanders, and everybody else who's here. So learn lots, ask questions, be attentive. Remember, this is not just a class that you're going to get here today. This is going to be something that's going to potentially affect you as you march on your careers outside the gates of this esteemed institution, okay? Esteemed institution, all right? So have a good time today, learn lots, get smarter, and use your talents wisely. Thank you very much.
Okay, so I'm Professor Sanders from the History Department. My role here today is just the moderator, which means I'm a glorified timekeeper. So I'm going to get out of the way and turn it over to them. We have Dr. Mark Hagen from Arizona State University to make some initial remarks to put it in context, and then we'll have Dr. Sakwa from the University of Kent in England, Dr. Sergii from Harvard University, Dr. Sysyn from Alberta, University of Alberta in Canada, all recognized experts in the field, and I'm showing up to turn it over.
Okay. Public universities with the biggest populations, and I'm a son of a veteran. Our president is a son of a veteran, so we were doing our service to those of us who have served us before. And as specialists on Russia and Ukraine, I feel like wearing many hats to talk to you. I teach also every summer in Munich to the Ukrainian Free University to young Ukrainians their history as an American, a German, Austrian. So I really am very happy to share what we know here. I want to start with a putting it right then on the table. Ukrainians today are dying, both soldiers and civilians, on the battle lines in Ukraine, in a fight that is our fight. And I think Ukraine is not the only battleground in this war with Russia, but it's probably the biggest and most important one, and the one where I think most is at stake. The Baltic states also feel themselves very vulnerable now. Moldova has been the longest standing frozen conflict, and we'll hear more about that later. Georgia also feels itself very vulnerable. Many of Russia's neighbors feel themselves very vulnerable, but the most violence has been happening in Ukraine, where there have been thousands of casualties on both sides, and up to 1.5 million internally displaced persons because of the war. I want to just sort of set the stage for everybody else's talks and just give you some basic history to explain what's at stake here, both internationally, diplomatically, politically, geopolitically. Even before even before Russia and Ukraine were independent Soviet Union, the democratically elected president of the Soviet Union signed in 1990, November, a treaty, the first treaty recognizing the territorial integrity of both republics and their existing borders. That was reaffirmed in December 1991, and a whole series of things, the Budapest Memorandum, 1997, Russian Treaty Friendship and Cooperation, and then we also put this in the context that 1997, NATO entered into a special partnership, and Russia joined NATO 2002. So things were not always as bad as they are today, and it wasn't even so long ago. Since we all midship men and women here, the Black Sea Fleet is something you probably would know best of anything else in the Russian military history. And the Black Sea Fleet, if you've ever seen, Dr. Sanders was teaching a course on film and history, but one of the most important films in his history of cinema is Battleship Potemkin, which starts with a scene of Ukrainian sailors in this Eisenstein film made in 1925 that is kind of a classic, and mostly it's about the steppes in Odessa, but it opens with Ukrainian sailors. So the Baltic Sea Fleet then, and up until recently, was very heavily Ukrainian conscripted. So all these agreements between Russia and Ukraine suggested that people could talk about how to divide up the Black Sea Fleet, which was part Russian, part Ukrainian, up until as late as 2010. There was an agreement to extend the split of the Black Sea Fleet between Russia and Ukraine until 2042. But then, November 2013, when the European Association Agreement was declined by then President Yanukovych, began the Euromaidan protests in Kiev. And here's the timeline, occupation of Crimea, and then Russia conducts a referendum recognizing Crimea as an independent state. A day later, with support from the parliament, Putin signed the treaty making Crimea part of Russia. A few weeks later, Donetsk and Kharkiv People's Republics declared the Kharkiv Republic fails, but the Luhansk Republic comes back. Petro Poroshenko wins elections via the first international consultations. Malaysia Airlines flight and Minsk Protocol. So that's kind of where we are. Again, I'm just going to start posing a few explanations, which will be filled in much more by people who follow me. Is this neo-imperialism, nostalgia for empire? How do we put it in the context of Russian Chechen War, Second Chechen War, the Russian-Georgian War, the re-engagement in Syria, Crimea and New Russia, and again, the longest frozen conflicts, dating from the Yeltsin Euro-Atlanticist days, Moldova and the Transnistrian Republic. So I'll stop it there, and we'll come back with some concluding remarks after we've learned much from my colleagues, my senior colleagues here. Okay. I'm always learning new things too.
So I failed to do something right before I get to one of you. I want to give you a second to sound so.
Okay.
So we have essentially, 45 minutes. We have it until 9 o'clock. We need 10 minutes or so for them to talk. So you all can divide that up. You can fight among each other and arm wrestle and see if they can. We'll try to keep you on track. 15 minutes or so.
With you, and hopefully there will be time for discussion, because I think already, as you've guessed, these issues are extraordinarily controversial, and obviously the Ukraine events of the last few years are both, in and of themselves, a massive tragedy and a massive political event. At the same time, I'm arguing, and I will be arguing now, that they're a symptom of a larger breakdown of post-Cold War order. So it's that's my key argument. In that, Mark just asked, what does Russia want? How do you explain it? Sometimes, one way of looking at it is its behavior, is Russia's behavior, a bit like the man who complains about his neighbors. And he says, he complains and says, look, my neighbor's absolutely awful. Late at night, they bang on the walls, they hit on my door, and they hit the pipes and so on. But it doesn't bother me. because that's when I practiced the accordion. So that was, is that the sort of way in which it works, like completely, yeah, the dialogue of death. The big picture, I will argue, is as follows. That, as you know, the Cold War ended in the late 1980s, Mikhail Sergeyevich Gorbachev launched Perestroika. The idea was, certainly in Gorbachev's formulation of the new political thinking, was that not just to put an end to the Cold War, the very heart of the argument was that they would be able to, this USSR as it was at the time, the United States and its allies, would be able to transcend the logic of conflict, and not just put an end to a specific conflict. The idea was to move into a whole new phase. This is what happened. And then not just Gorbachev, but the following leader, Yeltsin, and then Putin since the year 2000. Their basic argument is remarkably consistent. So all leaders, and any leader after Putin, will almost certainly make a similar sort of demand, which is as follows. The idea is, and the idea was, to transform what I call, and they call, the historic quest, that the Soviet Union and then later Russia would join it, this historic quest. And by the act of Russia joining it, it would become a greater West. That the West itself would change by Russia joining it. This would be what I call a dialogical process. By dialogy, I mean that the two actors change by putting an end to this Cold War, by putting an end to this conflict, and putting an end to this larger conflict, which was going on for at least for possibly 200 years of the evolutionary socialism. That in this engagement, that the historic West would become a greater West, and everybody would win. That this would be a wholly new situation. This would be what we'd call a transformation of the end of the Cold War. Not just to put an end to it, a transformation. This transformatory impulse continues to this day. In Russia, in other countries, the election of Jeremy Corbyn as leader of the Labour Party in that kingdom is also a reflection of this long tradition of transcending this logic of the Cold War. Unfortunately, this did not happen. And there is perhaps good reason for it. If Russia had joined the Soviet Union, later Russia had joined this historic quest, then the fear was that this would lead to normative dilution, a weakening of commitment to human rights and so on. It would lead to institutional incoherence. Okay, NATO worked. It seemed to have achieved its victory in the sense that it managed to, if you want to use that language, win the Cold War without firing a shot. And it would have also meant the loss of US leadership. It would have had to share leadership in this newly constituted greater Europe. So there were good reasons perhaps not to go that way, but that path is still the path which is required, in many people's view, to actually precisely prevent the Cold War, instead of which the Cold War and the institutions in which it was embedded continued. So you could quite simply argue the Cold War never ended. You've got NATO, which of course enlarged all the way to Russia's borders, and basically you don't need to be an expert in international relations to say if you have a military alliance which goes up to country X's borders without letting country X join it, then country X is going to be a bit upset and will in due course start doing counter actions against it. That's the sort of logic you could argue which we've found it. Yes, the Atlantic Alliance did a lot to try to sweeten the pill. It was, as we've just seen, the NATO-Russia Council, the Founding Act, and so on. But as the Russians say, we're always invited for the hors d'oeuvre, and we're never actually invited to the dinner, which is to join this alliance system. And we know that when Putin came to power in 2001, there were informal discussions. He really did want to say, okay, this dilemma needs to be resolved, and let us now discuss, and Russia will move towards joining NATO. And there were informal discussions in Brussels, which were continuing, and actually quite important. No one in Brussels, I've asked a few people, said, yes, there were such discussions in 2001, before 9/11. And then when Washington heard it, they said they actually banned it and said, no, you don't go that way. Perhaps for good reasons, again, but then it's certainly what happened. So in Europe, this transformation of the historic West to a greater West is the counterpart, is the attempt to establish what Gorbachev called a common European home. Today, it's called Greater Europe. This plan is also a consistent sort of model of vision of a post-Cold War future, which Russia advanced, and advances to this day. Even with this breakdown in relations today, Putin still talks about it. Lavrov, the Russian foreign minister, still talks about a greater Europe. This is a Gaullist idea. This is Charles de Gaulle, the former president of France. It's also mentioned by, a few years ago, Nicolas Sarkozy, a Union of Europe, in which he talked about a vision of an 800 million strong European market, of European society, all the way from Lisbon to Vladivostok. So this greater European idea is also a very powerful driver of all that is going on. So all of this failed in many ways, and then since then, the failure of establishing or transforming the historic West to a greater West, the failure of transforming what some people call the smaller Europe, that is the European Union, to become part of a larger pan-European community as one actor, together with Russia, Turkey, Ukraine, and other countries. The failure to create all of this led to the much more effort in the last few years to create a Eurasian type of union, Eurasian Economic Union in particular, but the aim ultimately is to achieve this Eurasian union. One of the conditions for allowing Russia into this community, the West, was do not start your own integrative integration projects in Eurasia. After 2012, Putin decided, you know, really that if we can't join the West, then we start our own. Although I can't go into detail about it, but simply say even that project, it was a way of trying to establish greater Europe through the back door. Even that project now has been subsumed by something far bigger, and that is now, since May 2015, the establishment of what our Chinese friends call Greater Eurasia. This is now Eurasian Economic Union and what Xi Jinping talks about, the One Belt, One Europe. This is now working towards establishing Greater Eurasia. This is a very, very powerful thing. It isn't just because Putin and Xi Jinping have met 18 times since Xi Jinping took over in 2013, extraordinary intensity. But this is now going on, and now just in Moscow recently. Endless, so at lower level, there's committees, there's commissions, there's now even, the point is, it's so intense this relationship that there's now effectively more flights, direct flights from Moscow to China than there are to the United States, which I think have been cut back lately. In other words, we see the emergence of a counter-hegemonic alliance, a very powerful one. One is, if you call it Kissinger's worst nightmare, where Russia and China are now quite explicitly moving into a counter-hegemonic. The failure to transform this West means that Greater East is emerging, a Greater Eurasia. Where does Ukraine fit in all of this? Obviously, that's why I say it's a symptom, not to in any way denigrate the importance and the subjectivity of Ukraine, but simply to say that is the larger picture in which it all was. Ukraine, unfortunately, was in this endless dilemma of forced to choose. And I think that it's a dreadful position to be in. We should never have been in a position where a country like Ukraine, Belarus, and so on are forced to choose whether integrating in with the West, European Union, the Atlantic community more broadly, or some Russian-centered project. Choice is the very fact of having to face this choice is catastrophic, that we weren't able after the end of the Cold War to establish an inclusive peace order in which all these countries could have thrived and developed with the support of everything. Because we know between Russia and Ukraine, deep economic, human, personal links, endless, and absolutely fine for Ukraine to join and become more closely involved with the European Union. These are just normal things. Just to say, I just got short time, just very briefly to say that in all of this, I do not take the John Mearsheimer line. Now, John Mearsheimer is the leading exponent of what some would call a very hard-line realist position. And he would say, a famous article in 2014 in Foreign Affairs, in which he argues the West is to blame for the Ukraine crisis. And obviously, he's right on the technical side of things, straightforwardly, is that it's simply in purely balance of power terms. You just have to be, you can't play both games, being idealist at the same time as expanding into space. It just doesn't work. You do get a reaction. But my view is rather different, is that the West, the traditional West, which failed to become the greater West, and now this counter-hegemonic alliance, which is emerging effectively, they both are committed, not to just simply classic balancing, they're both committed to what English school people would call international society. That is the institutions of the United Nations, of international law, and so on. So you have actually at the top level a kind of international society, but now within that you have multiple orders, and we're now seeing a clash of these orders. So, and so it's not just simply Mesa, I'm simply saying that states are just like billiard balls aligning. So, but in my life, this is my final point, that the West ultimately turned, and this was a great failure, it's what I call, we use the word monism, that was monological. In other words, that liberalism itself failed to be able to achieve and understand something outside of itself. There's a very large literature about this, about the failure of liberalism to actually be pluralistic. When I gave a similar talk a little while ago, basically the argument was people were saying, I was far too soft. In other words, was liberalism ever pluralist to anything outside of itself? That's the fundamental question. And that is, you know, is that the deeper theoretical position in which we find ourselves in. But so, you know, what we're saying is that this monist, the monological West, which argued we knew all the answers and all this endless talk of end of history and so on, and the institutional consolidation of something rather than its transcendence at the end of the Cold War. So all of that, this monism, if you like, has then fed back into Ukraine and has exaggerated the monological elements within Ukraine itself. So we then actually have a vision of Ukraine, it has to be pure Western, it has to be this model and so on. Whereas my argument, and I know it's a controversial one, is that Ukraine is by very nature a pluralistic society. It's made up of many communities, its enormous richness indeed comes precisely because of its way it was historically constituted spatially and in terms of nationality and its long history of engagement with Russia and many other states, Poland, Hungary and so on. So this is a genuinely pluralistic society. The failure since 1991 is to give constitutional form to its pluralism. In Wales today, where we're multilingual, you have to speak Welsh and English and Canada as well. Ukraine, also understandable reasons, and I'm sure you'll hear them. So bottom line is that Ukraine, unfortunately, has become more monist, which is actually feeding from Western monism, and they now reinforce each other. And so I think it's damaging massively to the European Union, which is now putting all of its eggs in one basket, this particular regime in Ukraine today. Whereas there is another Ukraine out there waiting to be given political and constitutional expression, and that is a multiple Ukraine, which would then, of course, help the Minsk process to bring back Donbass, because Minsk itself, if we talk about Minsk, is a recognition by Russia that Ukraine will, territorial integrity will remain as it is today, obviously without Crimea, which obviously, again, will not be returning to Ukraine anytime soon, if ever, just like South Ossetia or Abkhazia. It's gone, that train is gone. So we are where we are, and we now need to start thinking about trying to establish, as it were, a more pluralistic world order, and within that framework, establish a system or framework in which Ukraine can thrive as a multiple, as a plural society and nation, and thus working with Russia, as Donald Trump would say, what's wrong with having good relations with Russia? It's a good question, and I think it's an important question, and we really need to find an answer to it. Thank you.
Students who are mid-career officers in the army, but this is the first time that I'm talking to too many people, so again, thanks for inviting me. And the topic of my remarks is the role of history and basically how we can use history maybe to understand what is happening today with Russia, Ukraine, and generally in the international relations. And I would like to start with the event that took place at the beginning of this month, on November the 4th, the Unity Day in Russia. A monument was opened in the very heart of Moscow, of Russia's capital, across the square from Kremlin. And the monument is to Prince Saint Vladimir, as he's known in Russia, or Saint Volodymyr, as he is known in Ukraine. And this is the prince who ruled in Kiev during medieval times. He is portrayed in that monument with a cross and also with a sword. And the question is, what does the Kievan prince do in the center of Moscow? Another question is, not so much the question, but the interesting detail about how the monument was constructed. The founding stone was brought from the Crimea after the annexation of the Crimea by Russia. And it was Vladimir Putin who opened the monument and gave a short speech, which basically stresses the importance really in history in this current conflict, connection between Kiev, Crimea, and Moscow. And there is a lot of historical use and abuse of history in the current conflict. The monument, of course, points to the fact that the idea of what was the shared history of Russia and Ukraine is contested. It's contested in terms of monuments, it's contested in terms of territory. But history can be not only the way to legitimize either at the beginning or later things like annexation or things like war. History can be used also as the way to understand what is going on in the region. And I would like to start with placing the current Russo-Ukrainian conflict in the historical context. And when you do that, you find out that this is actually the worst crisis in the East-West relations since the end of the Cold War. Another thing that you find out if you put it into the broader historical context is that this is the first time since World War II, since 1945, that a major European power invades the territory of a sovereign state and annexes its territory. We saw a lot of invasions and conflicts, but the annexation, in terms of annexation of the territory, this is for the first time since 1945, since 1939. And what we see here also is that the entire idea of non-proliferation and nations giving up their nuclear arsenal is now in question, because the Budapest Memorandum was mentioned in 1994. It's a deal according to which Ukraine agreed to turn nukes to Russia in exchange for the guarantees that came ironically from Russia and the United States and a couple of other countries for its territorial integrity. So there is a lot of things that put this crisis outside just of the box of Eastern Europe or Russian neighborhood. Again, this is a major challenge to the international order, the way how it was created after 1945 and then restructured a little bit after the fall of the Soviet Union in 1991. So what does this mean and how history can potentially help us understand what is going on? My overall thesis is that what we are witnessing here is the process, very painful process, of the disintegration of the last traditional European empire. The 20th century in general is the period of the disintegration of the empires. The Ottoman Empire is gone, the Habsburg Empire is gone, the British Empire, French Empire, Portuguese, and actually the Soviet Union was able to continue the territorial existence of what used to be the Russian Empire, and its control over its people through a number of innovative policies accommodating the nationalities. But eventually history caught up with that imperial, post-imperial state as well. And this is, if I am right in this kind of a contextualization and understanding of what is happening in the region, it's not really good news for the region, because we know that process of disintegration of the empire can last for a long, long period of time. We have the Ottoman Empire. Again, we thought that in 1989, 1991, the history kind of ended, the liberalism won, and overnight what used to be communist and imperial state of the Soviet Union suddenly would turn liberal, and Professor Sakwa talked about the fact that it actually, for a number of reasons, didn't materialize. So now, next step, if this is a general framework, what we can learn from history and what it can give us in terms of trying to figure out where we move it. So the first parallel that is very clearly here, and a number of politicians, it seems to me Hillary Clinton got in trouble for that. That was the parallels between Putin and Hitler. And I don't think that they're very useful. But what is very useful from the point of view of a historian is looking at the ways of how Germany, after the defeat in World War I, and Russia after losing the Soviet Union at the end of the Cold War, behave and try to resolve of what in one case was the German question, which means the idea of nationalism when the borders of ethnic community and the borders of the state should coincide, and how Russia deals with that. And in both cases, we see this attempts to claim the territories that are suffered either by ethnic Germans or by ethnic Russians, and in violation of international laws. You see the start of World War II, that is closely connected to the dismemberment of Czechoslovakia when the Germans first claimed the German settled territories and then goes from there. And what we have here is, of course, the claim of the Crimea, which is largely settled by ethnic Russians. What complicates the question even more with Russia is that Russia, unlike Germany, doesn't really know, and Russian thinkers don't know, where Russia starts and where Russia ends, where Russians start and where they end. And the solution that Mr. Putin suggested in this current war is that the Russian foreign policy and, if needed, the Russian troops march as long as they hear Russian speech around them. So it wasn't just the ethnic Russians in the Crimea. This is Eastern Ukraine. So if you speak Russian, you have loyalty to Russian culture. That means you have loyalty to Russia. And that becomes really very dangerous. Again, Ukraine is one example, Belarus another, Kazakhstan another example, where a lot of population speak Russian without being ethnically Russian. And of course, what is at the top of the agenda of NATO is what will be happening with the Baltic states, with the country like Latvia, where, I don't know, 40% or 50% probably will speak Russian as well. So this is one important parallel to keep in mind when we think about where this crisis can be moving. Another one would be the Soviet and post-Soviet legacy. And what is interesting there is that in his speech on the annexation of the Crimea that was delivered on March 2014, Vladimir Putin very openly was talking about this big humiliation that Russia survived after the end of the Cold War with the disintegration of the Soviet Union. So it was very clear that at least emotionally he and people around him, they're driven by this idea of somehow rewrite the history after the disintegration of the Soviet Union. And you know what, for the first time since the Soviet period, Russia acquired an ideology which actually goes beyond purely national ideology and actually has international appeal. During Soviet times, those were communism, and again, there were communist movements and leftist movements all over the world. What we see today is the ideology of the Russian world, which is basically combines together the elements not just of Russian history and culture, but also values of the Orthodox Church and conservative values in general. So Putin emerges and Moscow emerges as actually a center of this conservative revolution that is supposed to take, or counter-revolution that is supposed to take place in the world. And finally, parallels with the Cold War. They're there. You look at the coverage in media. Are we in the midst of the new Cold War? I agree with Professor Sakwa that the Cold War really never ended, at least in the post-Soviet space. There was never agreement between Russia and the West what will happen with the countries like Ukraine and Belarus. But The situation is actually much more dangerous on a certain level today than it was during the Cold War. Again, the rules were very clear of engagement there during the Cold War, and also the Soviet Union was the country that wasn't revisionist. It was trying to keep what its troops acquired in Eastern Europe, let's say, up until 1945. Today, Russia is actually trying to claim new territories, to claim new influence in the world, and again, that's where the rules of engagement are not clear and situation becomes more dangerous. In conclusion, it's a lot of history, a lot of parallel. Does it really matter? We are living today, and the next world probably will bring something else. Probably it will, but again, we are talking generally about processes that span decades, if not centuries, like disintegrations of the empire, so the great power status and the attempt to claim it or reclaim, or the emergence of new nation states. These are things that not happen overnight, not happen within one day, and we're in a situation like that. So the first conclusion that I have is that actually we have to be prepared for a long haul. So that's the process that will not just miraculously end. It's change of guard in Washington, a change of guard in Berlin, or in Moscow for that matter. Another important lesson for me is that what was known in 1938 as appeasement, as basically attempt to satisfy the power that violates international order, is not a solution. It was tried with Czechoslovakia in 1938. It was tried after the Russo-German, the Russo-Georgian War of 2008, when actually it was not noticed, and if we have this opinion, okay, well, Crimea is gone, maybe it's gone, but it's kind of okay. Well, we will find ourselves in a situation where Russia expands not only to Syria, not only to the Middle East, but also further. So the appeasement is not the solution. And what is the solution? The solution is actually, in my opinion, is in the unity, Euro-Atlantic unity, and actually U.S. and Europe working together and staying and strengthening the ties in the alliance that is already there. And again, this is also today part of the debate. This is also a question today, and that's the argument that we have to do it because there is no other way. There is no other solution. Churchill used to say the only worst thing than having allies is not having them. So on this half optimistic note, I'm going to conclude.
Russian attitudes towards Ukraine and how I see them as central to the problem of ending this conflict and going forward to the border. But first I'd like to remind you that we now talk about the Canadian-American border as the longest undefended border. Well, we often forget that it was about 140 years before the two sides thought of it that way. Even before World War I, the Canadians were still planning what to do if the Americans tried to seize the prairies. That is, it took a long time in North America for those two rather similar societies to accept each other, and then to accept each other's differences as well. Now, what I would argue is that for at least a century and a half, Russian elites and political thinkers have, in essence, rejected the concept of Ukraine, and above all, that there is a Ukrainian people and a Ukrainian culture, and in many ways have tried to delegitimize those concepts, either the concepts that Ukrainians have a language, a culture, a nation, and above all, that they should have a state. We could go back earlier, but I won't drag you back to earlier periods. So we'll deal from the 1860s and move up to the present period. It was in 1863 the Russian Empire banned printing in Ukrainian by saying the language did not exist. It was a rather unusual act in Europe of that 19th century. And even though there were periods of relative accommodation, In the 1920s, for example, the Soviet Union experimented in allowing indigenous or various cultures to flourish. By the 1930s, the Stalinist onslaught had returned Ukraine in many ways to just a province of Russia, and it created a Ukrainian culture that was subordinate clearly to whatever the Russian culture would be. So in cultural context, there has always been a problem. Political rejection. Very early, as early as the 1860s, the Russian elites saw the danger of Ukrainian language existing because political demands would follow. And indeed, in a certain way, they were right. In 1917, when the Russian Empire broke apart, various groups in Ukraine tried to establish an independent state. That independent state did not succeed, failed by 1920-21. In many ways, the Soviet Union existed because that state existed. Therefore, the Soviet Union was formed as a theoretical union of different country states, but it was the Ukrainian issue that pushed that. They tried to integrate it into a Soviet Union. As I said, that experiment failed clearly by the end of the 1920s, and Stalin reverted to more imperial Russian thought. In many ways, one could argue that in 1933, the great famine that swept Ukraine, in which the Kremlin bears responsibility, was one of those nation-destroying processes that occasionally occurred in the Russian-Ukrainian context. Then in religious life, as early as the 1860s, Ukrainians tried to publish a Bible in Ukrainian language. The Russian Empire, a pious Orthodox state, would not permit that Bible in that language. And in many ways, the Russian Orthodox Church has served as a pseudo-imperial institution. Above all, the religious situation in Ukraine did not fit Russian models. There were, in areas of Ukraine outside the Russian Empire, considerable numbers of Catholics or Eastern Catholics. These have always not fit in a larger model. And since 1917 to 21, when Ukrainians tried to establish their own Orthodox Church in the way that Greeks and Bulgarians and Serbians have it, there has been constant resistance from Moscow and from the Russian Orthodox Church reconstituted to this Ukrainian church movement. Now, I've oversimplified these. You can, in many ways, find other tendencies in Russian thought. But all of these occurred and are, I would argue, the major stream. Now, where does it come from? Why do Russians have such a problem with Ukraine? Okay, why is it the Ukrainian problem? Already in the 1920s, a major Russian thinker, Nikolai Trubetskoy, wrote a big essay in the Russian Emigration on the Ukrainian problem. The entire Russian emigration was shocked by the destruction of the Tsarist Empire, by the Bolsheviks taking over power. But Trubetskoy was worried about where is this Ukrainian thing coming from and what a threat it is to us, that is to us Russians at that point from the Russian emigration. Trubetskoy was the leader of a movement called Eurasianism. It's a term you'll find frequently discussed. Eurasianism is the concept that there is in the great Eurasian landmass a civilization that transcends from what we might call Asian societies and above all steppe societies, the great expanses of Siberia, and parts of Europe. And that this Eurasian context is specific to what was the Russian Empire, and now was the Soviet Union, and is in a certain way the Russia of this day. It argued that this civilization, which in certain ways came from almost the roots of Genghis Khan and the Mongol society, was specific because in it, different political contexts prevailed because it had a tradition of reaction to what it was called Romano-Germanic civilization in the rest of Europe. Eurasianism also believed that, although there was a multi-religious Eurasian context, Orthodoxy, Eastern Orthodoxy, should play a specific role. And in this, it believed that Ukraine and Ukrainians were intrinsically a part of that Eurasian world, and indeed that Ukrainians had played a major role in the creation of Russian culture in the Russian Empire, and therefore had no right to create a separate or individual Ukrainian culture. Now, Trubetskoy was running an immigration in the 1920s, but in the Soviet Union, where the Bolsheviks and communists had created so-called a Ukrainian republic, many leaders of the Russian intelligentsia, right down to the end of the Soviet Union, had problems dealing with it. One very distinguished person is Dmitry Likachov, a great specialist in Russian literature, a man who was sent to the Stalinist gulag and comes back from it, but who believed that there was somehow an old Rus or an Eastern Slavic civilization that was different from Europe, that was the equal of Europe. But above all, he believed, as he said then, living in the Soviet Union, where Ukraine and Russia are two separate republics, both part of the Soviet Union, that Ukraine and Russia are like two celestial bodies, always mysteriously connected. That is, they cannot be divided. It is wrong to do so. And he said, and fortunately, their languages have remained so similar. What he left out was that in the 1930s, it was the Stalinist totalitarian regime that remade Ukrainian to be more like Russia. That is, that these things did not happen naturally. They happened because of policies and sometimes authoritarian. And then the great Russian dissident, Alexander Solzhenitsyn, believed very strongly in a Slavic state, an East Slavic state. At the breakup of the Soviet Union, he thought, fine, let the Balts go. I don't know how he felt about the Russian-speaking population there. Let the Central Asians go. We will go back to an East Slavic national core. Ukraine, Belarus, Russia, and northern Kazakhstan. Because remember, that huge Kazakhstan in the north has a huge population of East Slavs and Russian speakers. And he further said, and one of the problems is the creation of a distorted, perverted Ukrainian language that is driven from Russia. Now, notice these are moral, they're distorted, but even the word perversion is used for these, as if it is abnormal to have to create a literary language, and all of Europe did this. Now, what I would say is, in a short conclusion, is that we have, in a certain way, have a conflicting civilizational zones. And on the one hand, a Russian zone that is post-imperial still believes it must be greater than a nation, believes in many ways that Ukrainians and Russians are one people and one nation and should be, and rejects the West. There are other tendencies, Professor Sakwa has talked about them, but these tendencies have certainly come back strongly in the Putin period. We have a Ukrainian tradition that bases itself, above all, originally, on the idea of peoples having self-determination, basing itself on the linguistic reality that existed in Ukraine at the end of the 19th century, that Ukrainian was the overwhelmingly dominant language spoken in most of the area, but not the language of the dominant group, that such groups should have their states, and that for over the past 100 years, various groups have tried to establish a Ukrainian independent state, based on ethnocultural criteria, believing that they would be another nation in Europe, like Slovaks, for example, their neighbors, or like Czechs. Although over time, and particularly in the 20th century, as has been pointed out, Ukraine changed in its linguistic usage. Russian became a much more important language throughout the 20th century in Ukraine, despite the Soviet recognition of Ukrainians. So that in 1991, it was questioned by a very good scholar whose book I recommend, Andrew Wilson, is Ukrainian nationalism, in the sense of belief in an independent Ukrainian state, a minority faith? And in 1991, I argued against that. Now today, I look back in time, I begin to wonder about 1991. What was the disposition of the population? Soviet Union broke apart, Ukraine became independent. Part of the population, particularly those who spoke Ukrainian, but not only, believed it should be a fully independent state. Large areas of Ukraine, the population was much less determined on it, and many were still connected with a certain Russian-speaking world, and tied to the Soviet past as well. But 25 years have changed this very greatly. And even more, Putin has changed this very greatly. That is, for whatever reasons, the Russian rejectionism of even moderate Ukrainian identity have pushed increasing numbers of even Ukrainians who use Russian as their major language to think of themselves as quite different. But even more important, I look out at you, and I would estimate almost all of you were born when there was an independent Ukraine. Well, this has also happened to the population of Ukraine. A whole generation has grown up in an independent state. They have had varying political views. They now accept Ukraine as a civic nation, a state in which their identity is associated with the state, with certain Ukrainian traditions and certain feeling of a, and I would argue, in this case, Ukraine has accepted pluralism in many ways, the religious context just being one of the most prominent of them. In certain ways, the challenge placed by Moscow and by Putin, believing in a Russian-speaking world, orthodoxy as uniting all people, as the Russian Orthodox Church has become a state church, that there should be a Eurasian society in conflict with the West, are rejected by the majority of the population of Ukraine. Certainly, there may be adepts and groups that still believe in these, but they decline in numbers, even in the South and East, as we have seen graphically. And so in a certain way, the Russian rejectionist model has pushed further the processes and speeded them up, by which Ukraine has become a fully separate political entity. But it does not mean, obviously, in the current context, in which you have a Russia that is still rejecting the very existence, not Russia as a unit, but elites, who still reject that Ukrainians are a people different from Russians, that still rejects that Ukraine should have its own political future, means that this conflict is not going to disappear very soon. Thank you.
I'd like to say a couple of quick things and then open up the questions here. First of all, one of the things that we wanted to for you to see here today was that that scholars can have different points of view on these questions and explore them from different source bases and from different perspectives and come to different conclusions about that and that is happening here. Secondly, to say that these questions, as Colonel introduced, are vital and going to be part of your careers. That when you serve, there will be cases in which your COs go down through the chain and say, find out somebody on in my command that knows something about Ukraine. And so some of your background in this is going to be useful in your careers. Thirdly, is that the military efforts that the Russians undertook in Crimea and in eastern Ukraine are introducing new kinds of warfare in which they're using information warfare to kind of militarize the population, militarize identity. And they didn't actually invade Crimea. What they did is they introduced forces there who stood up as if they were insurgents and took over power. And then Crimea held this referendum in which everybody voted for independence in connection with Russia, and then Russia annexed it. And that danger exists in the eastern Baltic areas because we are, by treaty, NATO treaty obligation, obligated to defend the Baltic states if they're invaded by Russia. But what happens if it's an insurrection? We see that it's an internal matter among the population of those countries. So these things get very complicated. And you being informed on that is an important element going forward in your career. So I'm gonna open it up. I don't know if Mark has any general comments he wants to make, or I'll let you all ask some questions. Yes, please.
Good morning, gentlemen. Thank you very much. Recently, I was able to travel to Daugavpils, Latvia, which they proudly boast the most Russian city in the EU. When speaking with residents there, they claimed that a Crimea-like situation would be impossible due to their strong Latvian identity. At the same time, when traveling around outside of Daugavpils, the Latvian sentiment towards the Russian-speaking population seems very negative. As one young military officer told me, they're all lazy drunks. What would Russia need to do to engage this marginalized population, and do you perceive Putin challenging NATO directly?
Thank you.
just say, okay, Narva is probably the most Russian-speaking city in Estonia, and so I don't think you were right on that. Just a quick comment on that, and it's rather specific for this. It also shows regionalism within Latvia. Daugavpils is an area called Latgalia. It's a quite different cultural zone in Latvia. So for the rest of Latvia and Latvians, they looked at least more accommodating towards Russians. And those are the group you found so negative, which is interesting. I just add that on that as to what could be credit, and then leave for those who know more about current events.
Thanks for the question. It opens the door to a whole stack of issues which we've been discussing this morning. I think that the co-speakers are major experts, and enormous respect for them. But one has to say that I disagree fundamentally. With your final premise about Russia taking on NATO and so on, there is no Russian threat. What we've seen in Ukraine was a particular moment which had been leading up to for 25 years, the breakdown, which was not willed. Even Kissinger said in a famous interview that there's Putin, who has invested enormously in the Sochi Winter Olympics and was in the middle of celebrating the second week in the closing ceremony, and then he takes time off to invade another country. It just doesn't make sense. What Russia felt, and it may be wrong, but I'm not justifying it either. Simply saying one has to, empathy does not mean sympathy. But it does mean we need to explain the logic. And I do not accept the logic of what we've just heard. That in February, March 2014, Russia felt as a result of 25 years of being excluded from a military alliance which has actually come to its borders, that at that moment it felt it had no choice. The fear was, and it was a genuine fear, that the United States would take over the Sevastopol naval base. Initially, the plan was, we know the discussions now to some degree, though initially the idea was simply to take Sevastopol, the base, as a preemptive, not even NATO. It was going to be a US idea that they would move in and gradually, they talked after the overthrow of the previous government of throwing Russia out, of terminating the agreement which we heard. Which would allow the leasing of the base into the 2040s. The idea was immediate to stop that threat as soon as they could in 2018-19, and then this base. This would be a geostrategic failure, loss of Russia, which would be just simply unthinkable. And Russia and Putin, initially they realized they couldn't just take Sevastopol, they were going to take all of Crimea, and then they discussed how to legitimate it. They talked about the Russian world as a way of doing it. This was the moment in 2014, that famous speech on the 18th of March. However, since then, just a couple of times after that, but since 2014, this whole idea of expansionist Russian world does not work. That's not the way the system works. Putin is an extremely conservative, and their politician, his aim was, when he first came to power, was to settle these borders. And in fact, with Latvia and Estonia, he was obsessed by it. It was actually the Estonians and the Latvians who then in their own parliaments added, they said, let's accept the borders as they are. And then in Latvia and in Estonia, they both, the parliaments added, the Iron District, we accept them, but we must add the treaties of the 1920s, which were both those countries were much larger. And so we can go on. That ultimately, Russia feels itself in a complete strategic impasse, in a dead end, in a complete way, and it's lashing out, I think, probably unwisely so. In 2008, it's quite clear that Mikhail Saakashvili in Georgia, in August 2008, attacked South Ossetia despite endless warnings from Medvedev, who was the president at the time, just let's talk. And he believed, and it's now absolutely clear, that he believed NATO would support him. In other words, NATO now legitimates this sort of adventurous behavior by its clients in this region. Latvia and Estonia should clearly by now have given full citizenship to their Russian citizens. As you know, they do not have automatically, unlike the very generous settlement which took place in Ukraine in 1991 to give citizenship to all those who live in the territory. they have to go through. I mean, it's possible, and if there's a European Union insisted on giving them a travel document, which isn't an Estonian or Latvian passport. That's why in England now we have so many Russians from the Baltic in East Kent and so on. So, in other words, almost everything, I mean, Russia is an extremely conservative country, it is not expansionist, it's not a threat, it's now been whipped up into an extraordinary, you know, kind of a media campaign in the West, and I think it really is time to step back and actually say, what is the logic of Russian position? That Ukraine and Crimea was the exception, which is exactly against the logic of what Putin was trying to do. I'll stop there.
Well, again, it's an interesting discussion. We have different perspectives, and again, see what where my colleague is coming from, but it's difficult for me to accept Russia's non-expansionist character of its policy, because when you look at the map, it's not just Sevastopol, it's just the Crimea. And if Sevastopol and Crimea is an exception, why there is a war in eastern Ukraine? If Ukraine is an exception, why there are cyber attacks on Estonia? And why there are airplanes going all over Europe? So we can discuss what the sources of that behavior are and can be and who is to be blamed, but it's not Ukrainian troops or NATO troops taking over the Novorossiysk or launching cyber attacks on Moscow, shutting down the electric grid in what is now is the other way around. So whatever leads to that is it's Russia that is on the offensive now. And for me, that's just the facts. And for me, the big question is really that was just raised in the sense of we deal with a situation, new situation in the new world. This cyber attack, for example, shutting down the grid that was for the first time tried in Ukraine, it seems to me a year ago. Is this an act of war or not? So this kind of things were not covered by the treaties and agreements that were before that. The question of insurrection, again, not a new question. You have these things, again, Germany plays this out in Czechoslovakia. They have these plans to do it in Poland before they attack Poland. So again, it's not like absolutely new, something that didn't happen before, but again, I don't think that legally there is a clarity of that. And that's where, again, the most of the danger comes from, and it's what makes the situation, if not more dangerous, then certainly less predictable than it was during the Cold War.
And I would say as well that there are responsible parties within Latvia who are saying we have to change the attitude of our, we have to incorporate the Russian population in a civic nationalism, the Latvian civic nationalism. You have to understand that these countries were forcibly taken over by Stalin, that much of the intelligentsia, about 10% of the population, was sent there to the Gulag. So they have, you know, very sensitive national questions there. But the populations live there now. There are Russian populations there now. How are they going to accommodate them in this new situation? So, and the Russians are doing some active things among that population. So it's a very dynamic and aggravating circumstance that requires a lot of attention.
Professors, I'm John Mishavan. I'm one of the instructors here in the history department. I want to ask you, obviously we all know about Putin's call to President-elect last week, improving relations. What I want to ask you, do you think any kind of effective deal can be made between the new administration and President Putin? I'd say a lot of Americans, to do that would involve maybe Russia admitting guilt or responsibility in some way for the Malaysian aircraft shootdown, and maybe Edward Snowden being returned to the United States in some capacity. Do you think Putin would ever go for any of those things as part of a pulling back economic sanctions in the future?
Thanks so much. I think that's what the Trump presidency does do, is put on the agenda items which, in my view, despite whatever you may think about the messenger himself, but the message is, part of the message, I think an interesting one, which is putting on the table issues which should have been much more seriously discussed since the end of the Cold War. I mean, as you know, at one moment he said NATO was obsolete in the morning. He said that in the afternoon, of course. He changed his view on that question. But nevertheless, that is a question. What is NATO for, ultimately? And indeed, the Atlantic community, which we've talked about, is obviously important. It delivered enormous public goods. However, 25 years after the end of the Cold War, continues, of course, now, but 25 years after the end of the Cold War, what has failed to be achieved is a genuine continental vision. That is, by that I mean a European continental vision. Europe itself has failed to take control of its destiny. And the European Union is more and more marginalized in that Atlanticist concept. So, of course, looking from the United States, the strengthening of the Atlantic Alliance makes sense. Looking at it from a European public opinion, we'd say, this just doesn't make sense at all, because we have now achieved, a monstrous division, the full suffering Ukraine, in a division, a new Iron Curtain now being built from Narva in the Baltic all the way to Mariupol on the Sea of Azov. So we're back to where we were when the Berlin Wall and the Iron Curtain were separating. We failed. Europeans have failed to gain control of our destiny, the European destiny, and instead of which we are locked into an Atlantic system rather than a European continental system. Obviously, we're not talking about anti-American or anything like that. Obviously, any European continental vision has to work in close alliance with the United States. But it's different. It's separate. And that is what Trump is beginning to suggest. And on that basis, we can begin to see an end to this frozen conflict, effectively, for 25 years, this logjam. And it is not appeasement to talk to a world leader like Putin, who is part of the solution in all sorts of things, possibly even Syria. Well, I do believe in Syria as well, and many other anti-terrorism and so on. So when you say all of this, to make conditions, Snowden, of course, as Putin endlessly says, it wasn't he who invited Snowden to Moscow. It was the fact that the US cancelled his passport on the way he was on the way from Hong Kong to Cuba, as you know. And then he got stuck there. And as you know, for several months he was in the capsule hotel in Zona F. Yeah, of Moscow. I'll show you an image of an airport where I was last weekend. So he was just stuck there. So, it's not as if Russia does it. And remember, Putin said one of the conditions for Snowden to stay in Russia is that he doesn't work against the US interests. And so that was one of the conditions. And so, and Snowden, of course, is an obvious thing. As for MH17, well, obviously, that's a tragedy of the worst order, which, like the Vincennes business in 1988 and so on. It was an accident. But it was an accident, again, reflecting this monstrous situation in which Europe finds itself today. So, I do think that Trump's approach is not, I do not think that it should be at the expense of the smaller nations, Ukraine and so on. I mean, that's absolutely not. Eastern Donbass, the whole point of Minsk, as I said before, Russia accepts the integrity of Ukraine today, and obviously it is a global society in many ways, but it's accepting it. Crimea was a special case. I will insist on that.
So last I heard, the Poles, the Romanians, the Swedes are part of Europe. And I don't think Warsaw or Bucharest would feel this European worry about how the structure is now. They would feel, I think, in many ways, their capitals, that NATO is very important for them, that Russia poses a major threat to them, and therefore they are interested in shoring up the NATO alliance. And then as to deals, sure, Trump is a deal maker. You can make any kind of deal. The question is with whom you're doing the deal and what your long-term purpose is as well. So on the one hand, yes, if the U.S. is willing to give up the idea of a NATO world European alliance that is composed of democracies, and Russia is a state, the trappings of democracy, but I think in no sense would we call it a democratic institution. Sure, you can make the deal. What I fear more than that is who is making the deals from the American side at the moment. But that's, again, those are my political views, and how closely they are already integrated into Putin's world.
Yes, the deal is possible, and again, Cold War can serve as a basically some kind of a guidance. There were deals made between East and West on the question of Austria, on the question of Finland, this kind of a neutral situation. And there were discussions about so-called Finlandization of Ukraine or something like that. Again, the guarantees that, well, not guarantees, but assurances or whatever it would be that Ukraine is not part of NATO, but on the other hand, Ukraine is not part of the Russian Union. The trick is that can you make a deal with the country that was a guarantor of the Ukrainian sovereignty and violated it and invaded? So we can make deals. The question is how long they will last, and that's my biggest worry. Not even the deal per se, but actually whether you can deal this question.
We're supposed to schedule the end at 9:10. It's 9:09 now. I think if we open up another question, we'll run over that. So I think at this point, what I'd like to do is ask you to join me in thanking them for what they've shared.